Good morning, everybody. It is exactly 11 a.m., so we'll get the ball rolling here. My name is Lindsay Davis. I'm the Visitor Engagement Coordinator here at Soldiers Memorial Military Museum in downtown St. Louis. Thank you for attending this morning's program commemorating Pearl Harbor Remembrance Day, which also happens to be the 80th anniversary of the attack. While today's program is virtual, I'd like to remind you that Soldiers Memorial is open Wednesday through Sunday with COVID safety precautions in place. We'd love for you to come and visit us if you feel comfortable doing so. Before we begin, I'd like to thank the members of the Missouri Historical Society for their support. If you're interested in becoming a member, check out the link I'm about to post in the chat for more details. That is mohistory, mohistory.org/support. I also need to quickly mention a few details about today's program and how it will run. So first, this will be a 30 to 40 minute presentation followed with about 10 to 15 minutes of Q&A. You can submit questions through the Q&A button that's in the toolbar on Zoom. Please know that we'll do our best, but we cannot promise we'll get to every single question. Today's presentation is being recorded, so if you'd like to view it again or share it with others, take a look at our Missouri Historical Society YouTube page. I will put that link in the chat later on. Your feedback is always important to us. We'd appreciate if you answer a few questions for us after the program. A Kobo Toolbox survey will soon open another tab in your browser, so keep an eye out for it as you leave the session later. So before we launch into the session with our speaker, Paul Stillwell, we'd like to take a moment to honor the St. Louisans who lost their lives at Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941. The reading of their names will be followed by a brief moment of silence. John Calvin Atchison, Private, U.S. Marine Corps. Michael Lewis Vizzetti, Seaman, First Class, U.S. Navy. Paul Lewis Bomer, Coxswain, U.S. Navy. Frank G. Boswell, Private, U.S. Army. James William Brune, Radioman, Third Class, U.S. Navy. Frank Francis Funk, Boatswain's Mate, Second Class, U.S. Navy. George Themistocles, Seaman, Second Class, U.S. Navy. Lawrence Everett Grant, Yeoman, Third Class, U.S. Navy. Charles Eugene Hardin, Seaman, First Class, U.S. Navy. Keith Homer Harrington, Seaman, First Class, U.S. Navy. William Hughes Hyde, Coxswain, U.S. Navy. Arleigh Glenn Keener, Storekeeper, Third Class, U.S. Navy. Howard Ellis Maccabee, Fire Controlman, Third Class, U.S. Navy. Thomas Steger Sanford, Fireman, Third Class, U.S. Navy. Gordon Ellsworth Smith, Storekeeper, Second Class, U.S. Navy. Natale Ignatius Torti, Seaman, First Class, U.S. Navy. Robert Hines Westbrook, Private, U.S. Army. Robert James Windisch, Private, First Class, U.S. Marine Corps. Clarence Alvin Wise, Fireman, Third Class, U.S. Navy. Lloyd McDonald Zimmerman, Seaman, Second Class, U.S. Navy. Thank you for joining me in that moment of silence. Now I'd like to introduce today's speaker, Paul Stillwell. Paul grew up in Springfield, Missouri, and received a journalism degree from the University of Missouri at Columbia. He served on board two warships in the late 1960s, the USS Washoe County and the USS New Jersey. In the early 1970s, he was on the public relations staff of first the baseball Cardinals and then the football Cardinals. Since 1974, he and his wife, Karen, have lived in Annapolis, Maryland. He has worked with the U.S. Naval Institute in one capacity or another since then. He was the founding editor of Naval History Magazine and has written or edited 13 books, several of which deal with the events of December 7, 1941. The latest, published this year, is titled Battleship Commander, The Life of Vice Admiral Willis A. Lee, Jr. He also wanted me to tell you that he remains a fan of the baseball Cardinals, which is a very important note before we launch in. So Paul, thank you so much for being with us today. I'll stop sharing screen. And just so everyone in the audience knows, today's presentation is going to be interview style. So I will be asking Paul questions and he'll be sharing the story of Pearl Harbor with us. So Paul, you ready to go?
Yes, Lindsay, it is a pleasure to be on this program, especially with my St. Louis background. And it was sobering to hear you read the names of those men who were killed. It was an all-man shipboard Navy back, and also we had the Army and the Marine Corps. And this, as you mentioned, is the 80th anniversary, and this Pearl Harbor was a watershed event in the history of the United States and indeed the world. And I thank you for presenting the program and hosting it so ably.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you again for being here. Let's start with the basics of Pearl Harbor. So first, why did the Japanese decide to attack Pearl Harbor?
In 1937, the Japanese started a war against China, the Sino-Japanese War, and it was undeclared but very real, lots of casualties. This was part of what the Japanese anticipated would be the Greater East Asia co-prosperity sphere, in which Japan would be the dominant entity. The problem for the Japanese was they had very few natural resources in the home islands that could support a military action. So that meant going south to the Dutch East Indies, to the Philippines and Malaya, to get rubber, tin, and particularly oil. The president of the United States was Franklin D. Roosevelt, and there have been aspersions cast that he knew that the Japanese were going to attack and let it happen as a means of getting the United States into the war. I would utterly contest that. He loved the Navy and was not about to sacrifice it. However, in the middle of 1941, when the Japanese occupied French Indochina, Roosevelt put a oil embargo on shipments to Japan and also scrap metal. The Japanese felt that this put them in an untenable situation as far as getting those natural resources to the south, so they planned to strike south, and viewed the obstacle in the way of doing that as the U.S. fleet at Pearl Harbor. It had been deployed on the West Coast close to its support bases, and Roosevelt in 1940 had moved the ships out to Pearl Harbor, viewing them as a deterrent to Japanese aggression. Ironically, they turned out to be just the opposite. They were a magnet. The Japanese recognized they had to get them out of the way in order to carry out their plans. So Admiral Yamamoto, who was a commander-in-chief of the combined fleet, came up with a daring plan. He was a gambler, and in this case, enormously successful. Commander Minoru Genda planned it brilliantly. They had waves of high-level bombers, dive bombers, torpedo planes. They wisely chose a Sunday morning to attack when the ships would be in port, people would still be in bed. And at 5 minutes before 8 o'clock on December 7th, 80 years ago, the Japanese began bombing not only the ships, but also the airfields of the Army. And subsequently had a second attack, and then there the Fuchida, who led the attack, begged the Admiral Nagumo on board the carrier to launch a third strike that would knock out the oil tank storage and the machine shops in the shipyard. And it was to America's great blessing that Nagumo did not follow that advice, leaving Pearl Harbor intact as a base from which to begin the fight back against the Japanese.
Interesting. So what did the Japanese expect the outcome to be? Did they think that this would result in totally knocking the U.S. out of any capacity? Did they think that, did they expect us to kind of bounce back and attack back in the way that we did?
The plan of the Japanese government, including Yamamoto, was to so set the Americans back on their heels that they would sue for a negotiated peace. That is, they did not want it to be a long war, which they rightly knew would result in their defeat, because a war of attrition would cost the Japanese much more heavily than the Americans, who had greater population, greater natural resources, and greater industrial capacity. But in this case, it was a gamble that failed. It was a brilliant tactical maneuver, knocking out so many ships, killing so many people, but it had the opposite effect in terms of morale, because now the Americans were fighting mad. They wanted to revenge. Young men showed up to volunteer for the armed services, and the industrial capacity was cranked up for more ships, more planes, more bombs, more bullets, more torpedoes. And we know the eventual outcome 4 years later. So sad that so many lives were lost on both sides because of that miscalculation.
Yeah, with that in mind, is there any part of the attack you think the Japanese considered a success, that they felt it was a worthwhile endeavor?
Well, they certainly considered it a success from the tactical point of view, because they had knocked out so much in a short time. And as I said, they could have made an even greater triumph, but Admiral Nagumo was cautious. His specific mission was to knock out the ships and the airfields, which he did. And he was cautious that the Americans would counterattack, which really they had no opportunity or ability to do so at that moment. So he sailed home feeling mission accomplished. 6 months later, at the Battle of Midway in June 1942, the Japanese sent 4 of the 6 aircraft carriers that attacked Pearl Harbor with the idea of occupying Midway Island and then using that as a stepping stone to capture Pearl Harbor itself. And that proved to be another miscalculation, in that the Americans sank all 4 Japanese carriers. The landing force was not able to land. And from then on, the Japanese were back on their heels. The idea of a negotiated peace went away, and the Americans came forward strongly in a counterattack, went on the offensive in Guadalcanal in August 42. So the Japanese plan essentially backfired.
Yeah, turning from strategy and tactical matters to the experiences of people living on Hawaii and service members working at Pearl Harbor, why were the people on the island surprised by the attack?
Admiral Husband Kimmel was Commander in Chief Pacific Fleet. Lieutenant General Walter Short was Commander of the Army Detachment on Pearl Harbor. And it was literally inconceivable that the Japanese could come that far and do that much. One of the things the Japanese did was put wooden fins on their torpedoes dropped by the torpedo planes so that they would level off in shallow water. The thinking was that the harbor was so shallow that a torpedo could not successfully operate. Well, the Japanese found a way to accomplish that. On the 6th of December, Joseph C. Harsh, who was a correspondent for the Christian Science Monitor, had an interview with Admiral Kimmel. And he said, "Do you think the Japanese are going to attack?" And Kimmel said they'd be damn fools if they did, because that would bring Russia into the war. And they don't want to have a two-front war with America and Russia. So the mindset was not there. It was beyond the capability of imagination to believe it would happen. And the high brass in Washington also didn't think it would happen. They believed that the attack would go to the south, to the Philippines and so forth, which it did. And Pearl Harbor caught people by surprise. When they saw airplanes flying over, they thought it was an army exercise on a Sunday, which seemed strange. And then they saw the red ball insignia on the underside of the plane's wings and knew this is for real, and reacted remarkably quickly in the circumstance.
Yes. Moving from that, the USS St. Louis is named after our city. And so I was curious about the role that it played during the Pearl Harbor attack.
Thanks. Let me go back. That's a special ship in my awareness. She was built at the Newport News Shipbuilding and Dry Dock Company in Newport News, Virginia. And Navy custom and tradition calls for a woman to christen the ship with the name. And in this case, it was a young woman named Nancy Lee Merrill, a nice looking, beautiful young teenager. She had been crowned the queen of the Veiled Prophet Ball, and she was chosen by the mayor, Dickman, and the shipyard to be the sponsor. So that meant a trip to Newport News. In those days, it was by train, which is the way people traveled in the late 30s. In 1938, she went and she practiced her swing. She swung a bottle against the bow and said, "I christen thee St. Louis." The Post-Dispatch carried an article describing that event and said, "She made Dizzy Dean look like a sandlotter." Dizzy Dean, of course, being one of the greatest pitchers in Cardinal history. The ship was commissioned in 1939, operated in the Atlantic. In 1940, she went to Pearl Harbor to be part of President Roosevelt's desired deterrent against the Japanese. On that morning, according to the captain, he praised the crew because before he even gave an order to open fire, the anti-aircraft guns were firing. They were credited with knocking down 3 Japanese planes out of the total of 29 that were destroyed that day. The ship was in the shipyard, moored next to USS Honolulu, another cruiser. There was a gangway connecting the two ships, and the men of the St. Louis used a cutting torch to cut them free. They got steam up in the boilers in remarkably short time. And USS St. Louis shares the special honor of being the only major US warship to get underway in Pearl Harbor and get out into the open sea. That exploit earned her the nickname Lucky Lou, which held throughout the war. She lost very few crew members, but it was especially lucky that morning because there was a Japanese midget submarine lurking right outside the harbor. Submarine fired 2 torpedoes. Both of them had missed. Had they succeeded, the St. Louis would have been bottled up in the narrow channel so that ships could neither get in nor out. She went out to sea looking for the Japanese. Fortunately, they didn't find her because they had overwhelming power with their aircraft carriers. And Joe Taussig, an ensign who was on board USS Nevada and lost a leg as a result of being shot that day, said years later, "It was such a blessing that they hit us in port rather than at sea, because if we had been at sea, those ships would have been sunk, not able to be salvaged, and we would have lost many more lives." So in a way, it was a backhanded blessing. And as I said, it enraged the American people and led to the effort that eventually defeated Japan.
Wow, yes, certainly a credit to our city to have
yes.
that name and quite a story. Really, really does earn up to live up to the name Lucky Lou. Also, I was curious about the USS Arizona is probably the most famous of all the ships that were at Pearl Harbor. I know my family and I visited Pearl Harbor back in, I think, 2018, and that was one of the main attractions, isn't the right word, but one of the main sites at the Pearl Harbor Museum. So can you tell me a little bit about the USS Arizona and its role on that day?
I found out a great deal about that because on the 50th anniversary, I had a book published about the entire career of USS Arizona. And it was intriguing to go back and interview former crew members, virtually all of whom are now dead. I even was able to interview one of the original crew members from the commissioning in 1916. And this was 70 years later. And I said, what do you remember about the Arizona? And his answers, as you might guess, were pretty vague. Till I asked the key question, well, what did you think of Captain McDonald, the first skipper? That old son of a bitch put me on bread and water for 3 days. I went back to the ship's log for 1916 at the National Archives, and sure enough, he remembered that exactly as it happened. He said it wasn't fair, but he'd done something else wrong that he didn't get caught for, so they kind of balanced out. I talked to so many of the survivors. They had reunions annually out in Arizona, Tucson, and the stories were remarkable about what they did that day. One man, Jack McCarran, was a gunner's mate. And he was about to load a projectile into a 5-inch anti-aircraft gun. And he didn't remember what happened immediately thereafter. But he was blown overboard, found himself swimming in the water. It was covered with oil, which was a problem with many of the survivors, just get the oil off. So he went to the Naval Hospital for treatment, and he said when they took the bandages off, he'd been badly burned, he didn't recognize the face in the mirror as being the one on his ID card. So he wrote to his wife, Roberta, back in California, and he said, I'm no longer the man you married, forget about me. Well, fortunately, Roberta ignored his advice, and I had the pleasure of meeting them many years later at the reunion. And around the 49th anniversary, he agreed to sit down and talk with me. He said he had never told that story before, and it just poured out of him. And I felt such compassion for a man bearing that burden for so many years. And it was a delight to see the both of them subsequently. And then he wrote me a letter and said, I am so grateful that we had that talk, because I went back to my room at the hotel and I cried like a baby. But after that, I was able to remember the good times on board ship along with the bad. So that had sort of purged himself of the pain. Imagine living with that all those years. There were 1,177 men killed as a result on board the Arizona, the heaviest loss of life of any warship. And I talked to another survivor. He had been a young ensign at the time, and he was in charge of the compartment, living compartment for the steward's mates. And they had a white glove inspection, and the inspector came through and put his hand up on an angle iron. And when he brought it down, it was just filthy. So he told this young ensign, I'm going to put a dime up there. And when I come back for another inspection, I better not see that dime. So he came back a while later, put his gloved hand up again, looked at it. There was the filth, and there were two nickels. So he did not see that dime again. Well, that young ensign was one of a number of survivors who decreed that their remains, ashes, would be put down inside the ship so they could be with their shipmates forever. And shipmate is a special term in the Navy. One veteran said, friends may come and go, but shipmates are forever. And in this case, that became literally true. I have been on board the Arizona Memorial on a December 7th when divers took down the boxes of ashes and put them in there with the remains of those with whom they had served. I talked to Don Stratton, who was high up in the ship that morning, and the fire was getting ever nearer, and he essentially had two options: jump down straight into the fire and be incinerated, or wait for the fire to get him. Fortunately, the repair ship Vestal was alongside, sent over a line, a piece of rope, and hand over hand, he and a shipmate, Russ Lott, were able to save themselves. At a reunion, he pulled up his pant leg and showed me his leg. He had been wearing shorts that morning. He had been wearing socks. And you could see the flesh in between was badly scarred because that's where the fire had been able to get at him. Some of the survivors went in for reconciliation years later with the Japanese. He did not. He said, my shipmates are still out there, more than 900 still entombed in the Arizona. And he just died a couple of years ago at the age of nearly 100. And he specified that he'd be buried in a coffin on dry land. He did not want to be cremated. He said, I've been burned before. I don't want it to happen again. I'd like to share with you a letter. It was one of a number that a fireman, machinist mate named Bill Woodward sent to his wife, Virginia. They had married and then she was pregnant when the ship left California for the last time in the summer of 1941. They had a daughter named Karen, whom unfortunately Bill never got to meet, but he sent letters, and they're so touching to read how he pined for his wife. And let me share the last one. This is December 2nd, 1941, somewhere at sea. My own precious darling wife and baby. Oh, darling, I do so much hope that we go back to the States before long. There's a lot of talk that we will and a lot we won't. Myself, I'm afraid to say. I have built myself and you two up so many times for an awful letdown, it's just about to drive me out of my mind. So I am just praying and hoping and let the rest of the men do the talking. It shouldn't be so very long before we know one way or the other. And oh God, I hope it's right away. Well, darling, our little one was 4 months old the 30th, wasn't she? Darling, I do hope that you at least have some idea of how badly I want to see you both. I know you aren't having a very good time yourself, sitting around the house by yourself, taking care of the little one. It was so rough last night that I came off the 8 to 12 watch that I can hardly stay in my bunk. How is our little one, my sweet? Fine, I hope. Oh, darling, I can hardly wait to see her, as I've dreamed and thought about her so terribly much. I would like to see her at least once before she gets old enough to walk. After 6 months, my sweet, you will never have to be alone for a whole day again. I will be terribly glad when we get back in, because it will be that much closer to the 13th, and I want to get to mail, and I should have waiting for me three from you. I only received one letter this week, so I should make up for next week. I have an 8 to 12 watch this time, and it's really a killer. It seems as though you are on watch all the time, but it has its good points too, such as making the time pass faster. Well, darling, I must close for today and go on watch. 5 days later, Bill Wilbur is one of those 1,177 killed. He never saw his daughter. His daughter turned 80 this year and went out to Pearl Harbor to visit the memorial and pay homage to her dad. That memorial was built in the early 1960s. A little known fact is that Elvis Presley, who was in Hawaii to film a movie, put on a special concert at the Navy Arena in Pearl Harbor. And it was a benefit to raise funds for the creation of the memorial. Other funds were donated, and today it stands as an everlasting tribute, not only to the men of the Arizona, but to all those who gave their lives on that terrible day.
Wow, that letter really incredibly emotional. As you've mentioned several personal stories before, it's usually the personal stories that are the most compelling out of stories of that time. So I'm wondering if you have any other stories about how the events of December 7th impacted the locals and service members during that day. Any personal remembrances from survivors or really compelling tales?
Well, I just reread an article written by retired Rear Admiral Caleb Lanning. On that day, he was the executive officer of the destroyer USS Cunningham. And he and his wife, Mickey, were at home. They were living in Honolulu. And the radio was playing normal tunes. And then the announcer broke in to say, there has been an attack. We're under attack by the Japanese. All servicemen are directed to report to their ships or stations. And so he was able to hitchhike and then finally caught a ride into the harbor itself. And he stood on the dock to commandeer a boat to get out to his ship, which was moored not all that far from the Arizona. And there on the dock, he saw Rear Admiral Walter Stratton Anderson, who was commander of all the battleships at Pearl Harbor. And he said, the admiral just seemed to be stunned. These were his ships. And Anderson later did an oral history, and he said it was worse than Dante's Inferno, with all the fire and destruction. And he was sort of paralyzed by what he was seeing. And Lieutenant Lanning looked at him and urged him to get into the boat, to go out to his flagship. There wasn't really anything that Anderson could have done. I mean, the Japanese were attacking. He was ashore when they came. And I had the interesting pleasure in the late 1970s, when Anderson was long retired, living in New York City. And most of our visit, he was lying in bed because he was racked by arthritis, because movement was so painful. But this was a man of considerable will. He willed himself to get up to the dining room table for dinner. He had an Irish maid who served us, just as he had been served when he was captain of the West Virginia, when he was the admiral in charge of the battleships. He was still remembered that with style. Another example of his will was that he willed himself to live to be 100. He died in 1981, 40 years after the attack. He made it to the 100th birthday and died about 3 weeks later. So he was determined to do that. Another person who had great impact was Admiral Husband E. Kimmel, who was the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet. And he bore the brunt, really, of the blame for being caught by surprise. As I mentioned, he had done a newspaper interview the day before, which he thought the Japanese would be fooled to attack, and yet they did. And for political reasons, it was convenient for the people in Washington, including President Roosevelt, the Secretary of the Navy, and what have you, to create the impression that the blame lay all in Hawaii, not in Washington. Well, there had been any number of high-ranking officers in Washington who also did not foresee this happening. And Admiral Kimmel was vilified. He received letters, hate mail, said, you should kill yourself and make up for all the lives that were lost because of your negligence. He was essentially forced to retire in early 1942. He was charged with dereliction of duty for not having the fleet more ready. He was relieved in the middle of December by Admiral Chester Nimitz, who then commanded the fleet through the remainder of the war. And it was a brilliant choice for two reasons. One is that Admiral Kimmel might have spent part of his time trying to justify what he had done or not done. And also, he had an offensive mindset that would have, the idea would have leached off onto those remaining that he would try something perhaps that wasn't wise. So he was relieved. And he had to live with that the rest of his life. He lived until 1968. His sons, one of whom I knew, petitioned the government that he should be restored to 4-star rank because he had been demoted to 2-star after this happened when he retired. And the campaign went on for years. And his son said, well, I made sure of one thing. There are 4 stars on his tombstone. And I have been to that tombstone in the Naval Academy Cemetery. His son, who told me that story, is buried not far away. There was a review in the 1990s to see whether Kimmel had been unfairly treated, because the blame went to him, and especially because General MacArthur in Hawaii was also caught unawares, even though he knew of the Pearl Harbor attack hours earlier, and yet he remained on his job. So Kimmel did not have any chance to redeem himself. The conclusion of this report was that Kimmel was indeed culpable. The man in charge bears the responsibility, that's the Navy system and throughout the armed forces. And yet there were other things that he could have done to get the fleet more alert. He might have put submarine nets around the ships that eventually got torpedoed, not submarine nets, but torpedo nets. They might have had part of the anti-aircraft batteries manned. They might have had a higher state of alert, but they didn't. And so he does bear that responsibility. The conclusion of a report that came out in the 1990s was, yes, he was to blame, but there were any number of others who also did not foresee this and were allowed to continue their careers. So essentially there was more than enough blame to go around, but it fell on him and on General Short, his Army counterpart. So history has a way of dealing with things, and that essentially was the final verdict on Admiral Kimmel.
I can't imagine the weight that would carry for the rest, anyone who experienced Pearl Harbor, and especially people in positions of authority. I can only imagine the kind of perhaps guilt, perhaps sadness that one would carry for the rest of their life. If you don't have any other stories you'd like to share, we can move on into the Q&A. I know there are, looks like, three questions up already. Does that sound good to you, Paul?
Sure, thank you.
Okay. So I believe our first question comes from Linnea, I believe is how you say her name. My apologies if I'm saying that wrong. Asking if you could speak a bit about the US's immediate response to the attack and FDR's speech on the 8th.
Excellent question. I read an account given by Frances Perkins, who was one of his cabinet members, the first woman to serve in a president's cabinet. And the president had a cabinet meeting that night, and he seemed bewildered. He was angry, but also so sad that his ships had been so badly mistreated. And he dictated a speech, which is one of the most important in the history of World War II, before a joint session of Congress, and called for a declaration of war. And he said, December 7th, 1941, is a date which will live in infamy. And that word infamy has clung to it. He rallied the nation. The Congress passed the declaration of war against Japan almost unanimously. There was one female representative who voted against us, Jeanette Rankin. She had also cast a vote against declaring war in World War I, so she was certainly consistent. But FDR's speech roused the nation. As I said, people went down to enlist, to donate blood. The war industries really cranked up. Speed up the ships, speed up the production of armaments. And sadly, ironically, I should say, Germany a few days later declared war on the United States, which it had no outright reason to do. And in fact, in the Atlantic in 1941, Roosevelt had been baiting the Germans to do something because he really wanted to go to war against Germany to support Winston Churchill against Hitler. So it was a gratuitous gift for Germany to declare war. Now, the United States would have a two-ocean war that would take nearly 4 years to win.
Interesting. Thank you for answering that question. The next two have more to do about the idea. This is an anonymous attendee stating that, as I vaguely remember, many of our ships the Japanese had hoped to destroy were out at sea during the attack. And so if so, did the Japanese not care that all the ships were not in the harbor? Were they satisfied with the amount of damage they inflicted? Then they said, it seems like the Japanese would have had some intelligence services that knew where US ships were located.
Another excellent question. The primary targets were the battleships, because up till that day, they were considered the backbone of the fleet. And Admiral Kimmel's plan had been, when hostilities arose, the ships would steam west and encounter a big battle with the Japanese, perhaps in the Marshall Islands. In retrospect, that would have been a terrible plan, because the Japanese would have been closer to supply their forces. It would have been a long, long slog for the American ships to get there. Well, that plan disappeared that day. So in early 1942, it was really submarines and aircraft carriers that began waging war against the Japanese. It was truly fortuitous that the aircraft carriers Enterprise and Hornet, rather Yorktown, were out at sea. They had been delivering airplanes to beef up the defenses at Wake Island and Midway. They surely would have been prime targets, especially for the Japanese aviators who plan and carry out the attack. They knew the value of aircraft carriers. They were proving it that very day. Those ships were instrumental in the Battle of Midway 6 months later. And there was an old battleship, USS Utah, that was on the other side of Ford Island from the battleships. And she had been a target ship and had wooden planks across the superstructure. So they probably took her for an aircraft carrier and really torpedoed her. She sank part of the way over, and her rusting remains are still at Pearl Harbor. You can see just the top of them above the surface of the water. And now there has been a USS Utah memorial erected to honor her and her crew. The Japanese, unlike the St. Louis, were unlucky that day in that they didn't get the ships that really mattered.
Gotcha. That looks like all the questions that have come in. I'd like to probably give another minute. We still have some time if anybody else has other questions they'd like to ask Paul. So I will give people a second if they want to start furiously typing something in.
Well, I can say a bit more about Nancy Lee Morrill.
Yeah, go for it.
In 1972, I was living in St. Louis. By that time, I was working for the football Cardinals. And I periodically wrote feature articles for the Post-Dispatch. So one Sunday night, I called her out of the blue. And she was by then Mrs. Robert Smith. Not quite as memorable a name as Nancy Lee Morrill. And she was truly a gracious lady. She said I had interrupted her while she was watching the movie Patton, but she was willing to listen to me. She invited me to her home, and it was such a treat to meet her, to hear her recount the events that had tied her to this ship. And the ship went out of commission shortly after World War II, because there were then more modern cruisers in existence and better suited for the post-war environment. But in 1951, the Brazilian Navy bought the former St. Louis from the US Navy and took her south to be the flagship of the Brazilian Navy. She was named Almirante Tamandari, which means Admiral Tamandari. He was the founder of the Brazilian Navy, and for years and years she served in that capacity. And Mrs. Smith by then went to Philadelphia, where the ship was in mothballs, and she was part of the ceremony at which the international transfer was made. Then years later, the ship had outlived her usefulness in the Brazilian Navy, and she was due to be scrapped. And so the wheel from the St. Louis was removed from the ship, sent to the city, and made a permanent exhibit at the Soldiers' Memorial. And she was present for that as well. Gracious throughout. I mean, this was her ship. She had helped give life to it, and now she was helping to give it a permanent memorial. The ship was decommissioned by the Brazilians and due to be towed for scrapping in Hong Kong. And as she rounded the tip of South Africa, the Cape of Good Hope, the tow line parted. The former St. Louis sank to the bottom of the sea. So instead of being scrapped, she's still essentially the same was when she served in our Navy and the Brazilians. And I would suspect that this alumni from the ship treasured that moment as one more effort for her to fight back.
It's quite lovely that Nancy got to have like this full circle moment with the ship throughout its entire different life cycles. It's quite amazing that that was able to happen. And the ship went down as she lived, I guess, is the way to put it. So I don't see any other questions, and that's totally fine. So I figured we can start wrapping up. Definitely like to thank you, Paul, again for this lovely program. I certainly learned a lot, and what a great way to commemorate the 80th anniversary and keep this story alive. I also like to say thank you to everyone who has attended. Wait, did somebody put something in the Q&A? The last minute, someone just said thank you for a wonderful way to remember Pearl Harbor. So there's that nice little send off from the audience. I'd also like to thank everybody who may be watching this on YouTube later on. And as a reminder, an evaluation COBOL toolbox will pop up in your browser after you exit this session. It would be really important to us to get your feedback. So if you have the time, we would love to hear from you. If you enjoyed today's presentation, I've got great news for you, because we have, let me pull up share screen again, see if it lets me go on to the next slide. Yes, we have a program tomorrow afternoon at noon. It's one of our part of our Chow and Chat series with the Civil Air Patrol. Feel free to bring your lunch if you'd like to come and join us. We also have a very exciting program on January 7th, which is a Friday at 11 a.m. It's called Canvas is the New Cashmere. Our curator of clothing and textiles will talk to us about how military uniforms have inspired civilian fashion through the years. So I'm personally very much looking forward to that one. I hope you all have a great rest of your day. Again, thank you so much for tuning in.
Thank you. And I just like to add one final thought. It not only changed the war, it transformed America, because it provided opportunities for individual citizens that had not really existed in great numbers up to then. Speaking specifically of women and African Americans, women were called into the service, they served as yeomen, and the idea was they can free a man to fight. And one brief incident in my new book about Admiral Lee, he was in Washington at the time at the old Navy Department building. And the policy at the time called for seniors to address enlisted personnel by their last names only. Well, it turns out that he had a cute female yeoman whose last name was Angel. And he got kind of embarrassed sometimes when somebody would be on the phone with him and he'd say, well, Angel, would you come in and bring me that piece of paper I need? And turn red in the process. As for the African Americans, they got into the war industries. In early 1942, they no longer had to be cooks and servants serving the white officers. They could go into any of the ratings that were held by all the sailors in the Navy, and made a tremendous contribution in that regard. It changed society, because you weren't going to unplug that leak that had started, because in 1948, President Truman officially desegregated the armed services. Women have remained an increasing presence in the employment, now CEOs of companies and in academia. It was my pleasure to interview 8 of the original 13 African-American naval officers. They were commissioned in 1944, became known as the Golden 13. These were the counterparts in the Navy of Jackie Robinson in baseball, Thurgood Marshall in the legal profession. And to hear the stories directly from them and to become friends in the process has been one of the most fulfilling experiences of my life.
That sounds like a fascinating story. Thank you so much for adding that on here at the end. Again, thank you everyone for showing up. It was so great being able to tell this story today on this anniversary. So again, thank you. We'll wrap this up here. Have a great day.
Thank you.